everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our SharePoint Security Lessons Learned webinar. Just a little bit about Protiviti before we get started. Protiviti is a global consulting firm that helps solve problems in finance, technology, governance, risk, and internal audit. We have offices in 70 different cities over 20 countries. Our Protiviti SharePoint Solutions Group offers consulting support, training, and add-ons for Microsoft SharePoint. I'd like to invite everyone on the call to SharePoint Project Management Symposium, June 15th in Reston, Virginia. It's only $99, and PMPs can earn 7 PDUs. We have 4 PMP speakers and 1 MVP presenting. You can learn more about the event at sharepoint.protiviti.com/PM Symposium. For today's session, our topic is SharePoint Security Lessons Learned. We are recording today's webinar. You can access the recording at youtube.com/ProtivitySP. For your questions during today's webinar, please use the question window or you can tweet us at ProtivitySP. We're going to save all the questions until the end, but you can insert them at any time during the presentation. Today's presenters are Antonio Maio, SharePoint MVP with Protiviti, and Benjamin Niaulin, Office 365 MVP with ShareGate. So I'm going to turn it over to Benjamin and they can take it from there.
Thank you very much. Just making sure everybody can hear me.
Yep.
Perfect. I'm going to slide this little, whoops. All right, so thanks again. Very, very excited to be here today with Antonio. Antonio, for me, is the master of SharePoint security, and I think the other master of SharePoint security is also at Protiviti, Liam Cleary. So I'm really excited to be here and to go over these some of the lessons learned that we've had or that we've both seen, some of the experiences and some tips that we can share with you, of course. So again, hi, Antonio. Thanks for joining.
Hi, Ben. Good to be here. How are you doing?
I'm pretty good. So the reason why both Antonio and I wanted to, let's see why are we here today, right? What brought us to talk about SharePoint security? Why not talk about the new Office 365 stuff? Well, there's still a lot of things going on, and even more so with Office 365, in fact. So it's important to be able to look at what's going on for our security and make sure that we can enforce it. Now, I'm going to remove my little pop-up. There we go. There's a recent study, February of 2013, done by eMedia, and I'm going to read it, but it's very important to understand, so I invite you to check it out fully on their Info Security magazine. Only about one-third of organizations with 25 to 5,000 users employing SharePoint have security policies. Even worse, just over one-fifth, or 22%, admitted that they don't even have one and won't be making one. So they just kind of put SharePoint into place and hope for the best kind of thing. And to be honest, I'm actually seeing that a lot. SharePoint got them with the licenses that Microsoft gave them, and then what happens next is people just put their file shares into it, roughly put some security, and move on. I don't know, Antonio, have you seen anything of the sort on your side?
Yeah, absolutely, Ben. This is a great stat you have here. From the ground, what we see often is that organizations deploy SharePoint, and SharePoint grows pretty organically in a lot of companies. People start using it, and companies very quickly find they have what we would call a lot of content in SharePoint. So let's say thousands, tens of thousands, sometimes hundreds of thousands of documents. And we see that security is often an afterthought. So many of you use the end users that are using it day to day. Don't have any security policies by which they use it by, and the organization often has no security policies, or what we often call governance policies, for controlling how employees interact with content or what they do with sensitive data or who they go to get access to data they need for their job. So yeah, we do see this a lot in our data.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think we even cover some of the governance policies kind of tips in this session as well.
Yeah, very much.
All right, so actually this one is definitely for you, and in fact we've created a little cartoon at the bottom left here so you know when it's your turn.
Thanks, Ben. Yeah, my kids love that cartoon. A lot of people know this name. Edward Snowden's responsible for probably one of the most famous or infamous security leaks of all time right now. And it's pretty well documented that a lot of the information, or a good portion of the information that was leaked by Snowden, actually came from SharePoint. And he gained access to that information by convincing SharePoint administrators to give him access to that sensitive content. So this is actually a great example, or a terrible example, depending how you look at it, of not having the appropriate security policies in place, or an organization not having the appropriate checks and balances when people ask for access to content.
Absolutely, right? Because, I mean, it goes even beyond, yes, you got the administrator privileges, but just in general, with SharePoint, there's a powerful search engine. So as soon as you get access to something, you can very well easily find things that you didn't even know you had access to, unlike before you really had to go through it. So, yeah, very, very, very scary on this one. So, oh, yes.
Yeah, so full control. So this is also an issue that we see at a lot of clients. This is, I find, giving people full control is often an issue that occurs by administrators not really understanding SharePoint, or not necessarily taking the time to understand how SharePoint permissions work. And what I mean there is SharePoint administrators often have very busy lives, busy jobs, and they're often asked for access to content. And they'll often give users full control to sites or libraries or documents. And this often happens because the administrators know enough that at least if they give someone full control to content, they're giving them enough permissions to do their job day to day, right? They're giving them permissions to access the content and actually accomplish what they need to accomplish. But what they don't realize is that giving someone full control often gives them complete access to all permissions related to the site or the library or the document or what have you. And that gives that person permissions to do whatever they wish with the content, including granting other people permissions. So this is often an example that we see out in the field. People are busy. People often don't have time allocated to manage this type of thing in SharePoint effectively. And usually it's the least past the resistance to give somebody full control to content so that they can get access to that information and do their jobs.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And actually, funny story. Actually, it's funny now because it wasn't funny back then. But I was working at a customer, a fairly large company, and in the engineering field. They have about 3,000 to 4,000 users, and they're in a military context. So security for me, obviously not for me, but for them, was extremely serious. But just an overall management of their SharePoint was, and I was there for roughly 5 months, and I thought, maybe I'm allowed to go for 1 week vacation. So I decided to give over some power to a power user, or an advanced power user, somebody that was on the SharePoint team, which I trusted, of course. So I went on this 1 week, 5 days vacation, come back. What happened? Well, under one site collection, we found about 200 and somewhat subsites. And I wasn't happy. What happened? Why do we have 220, or I forget what the number was, but why do we have so many subsites? And the answer was, I needed to create a new page. Well, why didn't you create a new page? And that person just misunderstanding SharePoint and me giving that person too much power, because by default, the site owner, the owner's group, or we'll talk about full control, has the ability to create subsites. And believe me, I've learned from that mistake, and I really rarely give anyone the ability to create subsites. And I have a sort of a workflow, approval workflow that goes through a certain process to make sure that I approve. But we'll talk about that. But I just wanted to talk about full control, because when we say lose control, when you give control, is absolutely true in SharePoint. I've seen many times where SharePoint just becomes chaos, where people create lists of libraries everywhere, create sites everywhere, create tons of different things everywhere, objects, and then I just completely lose control myself because it's so difficult with SharePoint to figure things out sometimes. So
engineering groups are a great example of that. You know, they're usually dealing with a lot of content. They're busy people. They have lives outside of SharePoint. And when they give full control or access to other people, no one ever goes back afterwards to edit those permissions or clean them up to turn them into what they should be. So, yeah, it's a great example of losing control.
Yeah. No, I 100% agree. And this one's a funny one that, I mean, another story, it was actually much before than it was in 2007, with SharePoint 2007. And I remember clear as day, somebody just calling me up as a SharePoint person and saying, hey, my library's gone. I just showed up to work. My document library is no longer here. I don't know what happened. You got to have to fix this for me. So obviously me, I trusted the person. This was my first, that was my beginnings in SharePoint, really, with 2007. And I thought, all right, yeah, let's check it out. Let's pull out the ULS logs. Let's see what SharePoint did. Where is there corruption in the database? You know, and then after 10 or 12 minutes, it clicked. Wait a minute. And I checked the recycle bin. And guess what? There's the whole document library right there in the recycle bin. And who deleted it? That specific person. So, of course, you try to be nice and you try to tell them, oh, look what, it looks like you deleted it, but it must have magically happened. But, again, it goes with too much power. The people allowing them to delete list, delete library is not always. So I see this. People that don't know how to use SharePoint are granted too much power. I don't know. You've seen some things like this too, no?
Absolutely. We do often see this. And you know, end users within SharePoint often don't necessarily understand the ramifications of the actions that they're allowed to do. And this you know, goes back to controlling who has access and what type of access they have to content, right? If someone's accessing documents within a library, they really shouldn't have the power to delete that library.
Absolutely. And it becomes even more dangerous in SharePoint 2013. Now, we've opened the door, so I'll go and peek inside this door quickly. But for those of you here on the call, you'll know that in 2013, they changed permissions a little bit. And by default, a group, the members group, which only has some basic permissions in 2010, automatically gets more permission in 2013 with a new permission level that was introduced. So that is very scary, especially for migrations, but we'll cover that in just a bit. But this whole thing is definitely scary, yeah. And this is another one, and again, remember, we're covering, before we go into the tips, we're kind of telling you about the stories. This is really very much for me and Antonio. We're sitting in that chair, and we're letting it all out. We're telling about everything that we've seen until we're ready to give some tips, because somebody has to say them. In SharePoint, it's also very difficult to know who has access to what, because permissions is granted everywhere, and the more you break permission, you'll see the harder it becomes. And to figure out who has access to what, there's only limited, if anything, that's possible. You can check permission through site collections, but you can't really check permission across the board. It's unless you go pull out things like PowerShell or start coding something. There isn't really a, hey, what does John have access to in all of our SharePoint in terms of documents or in terms of unique permissions? You really have to go site collection by site collection. You have to manually go through the steps and get some information. It is definitely very difficult. What about this one, Antonio?
Yeah, so this is another situation we see often in the field, where clients that we deal with tell us we don't put sensitive data in SharePoint. We store our sensitive data in some other system, and we limit access to that system really heavily. When we need to share that content with someone else, we password protect those documents, and then we email them out. And it's really important to understand, I think, that every organization has sensitive data. The people that we talk to who work with sensitive data day to day, they often prefer to keep that data where it is. They feel it's more secure where it currently is, as opposed to putting it in SharePoint. And I often find that that's because people are more comfortable with where they have that data today. They're more comfortable with what they know, right? And they're more comfortable with traditional, I'll say, IT models of securing who has access to a system, as opposed to who has access to the specific information, right? They're more comfortable with that kind of model. In some cases, that current process might be more secure, but often what I find is that when organizations look at the sum total of people that actually have access to their system, and I mean including things like the people within the IT team that need to back up that system, right? People that perhaps work on that system from a configuration or a development perspective. When you look at the sum total of people that actually have access to that content, it often tends to be much more than the organization realizes, right? And when they truly consider the capabilities that SharePoint gives you for securing that information, whether it's at the site collection, sites, list library, or at the individual document level, SharePoint gives you much more control over who can access the content. I believe it secures it better, but at the same time still allows you to share and collaborate with the right people, right? And another aspect of this is if you think that password protecting Office documents helps to keep them secure, I'll just suggest that people Google a little bit for free apps out there for cracking password protective Office documents, and you'll find that you'll be able to freely download an app pretty fast and crack a password-protected Office document in probably just a few minutes.
Yeah, no, absolutely. To hop on that, they probably won't be called hacking documents. They're probably called recovery, right? Because it has happened to me many times. I put a password, and this was back before, but I don't do that anymore. Password protect a document, completely forget the password, go online, find a tool that recovers my document, and there you go.
That's right. And usually the organization's IT team even has those tools on hand for exactly that purpose.
Absolutely. So yeah, definitely look into SharePoint for that. It doesn't mean that it's not as good. And this actually happened while I was doing training, and it even happened to myself once. I'm not going to lie, I'm not perfect. This happened before. But essentially, I removed myself as an administrator of the site, and I can't do anything. This is usually the case when somebody wants to give access to someone, and they kind of just remove themselves to add themselves in another group, but they forget that by adding themselves, it's too late. So they usually do it in the wrong order. So this is, again, a classic mistake of giving somebody too much power. They shouldn't probably have an administrator in the first place.
Antonio,
do you see that
actually
sometimes? Or?
Yeah. Absolutely. I've done that myself accidentally. And you always hit your head against a wall after you've done it.
Yeah, because after that, you're going to have to go see somebody and ask
them
to put you back.
That's exactly it.
Oh, this one, I'm going to let you take it away because this is a big, important piece of performance and permissions.
Yeah, there's a lot of different aspects of SharePoint that can affect performance, but one that's definitely important to keep in mind is the idea of security. And what we're talking about here is SharePoint permissions and assigning them at the individual document or item level. So what's important to understand here is that if you're in a situation where you're assigning many permissions to individual documents and items, what we typically call those is fine-grained permissions. And assigning fine-grained permissions to large amounts of content within the same lists or libraries can seriously affect performance of SharePoint. There are some specific limitations there, and we're going to talk about those a little bit later in the presentation. But this goes back to understanding SharePoint security capabilities, understanding the ramifications of certain security configurations, and in particular these limitations. So we're going to talk about those later in the presentation, but definitely if you find SharePoint is running slow and you're in a list or library that's very large, you have say tens of thousands of documents or items, and you suspect that you might have many permissions, individual unique permissions on each document or item, that definitely could be a cause of the library acting slowly.
Yeah, absolutely. This one I've seen many, many times. This is probably one of the main reasons why we often get called is because, well, my SharePoint is slow. My SharePoint is extremely fast. It's once we start putting our hands into SharePoint and configure things and change permissions. So I would say quickly a tip, if you're starting to see that you have to do a lot of unique permissions, that means you change the permissions of a document. So we're going to look at the different levels of permissions within this session, but if you find yourself in a library and often changing the permissions, then this probably an architecture or a planning problem. You may have to go back to the drawing board because ideally you don't you wouldn't want to do this for these performance reasons we were talking about.
Absolutely.
So yeah, what happens is now before you'd be on your file share and you'd know that all you have to do is manage the security on your file share. But with SharePoint, with Office 365, with OneDrive for Business, security is no longer just managing folders and the permissions that are on these folders. Now you're managing so many different things. You've got to be managing the sites, the lists, the libraries, the content types, the pages that get created. And if it's an Office 365, do you have to manage groups, the whole groups for Office 365, which is kind of like the new team site in some ways? That's also very different in terms of security. Then you have OneDrive for Business. Now, I usually don't say this out loud, but I'm going to tell you a little story just so you understand the issues that go on. Is with OneDrive for Business, and actually even with the team site, it's the same scenario. Even us at ShareGate, we've had one of these issues. Right? What happened is we have a team site, we're working on all of us, OneDrive for Business and SharePoint on Office 365 introduced the concept of external users, the people outside of your organization. We shared a document, one document we shared with one person outside of our organization, but somewhere else on the site collection, we granted a list or a document library to the everyone group, which automatically includes, of course, the external user that we had added previously. So not knowingly, we had granted them access to the entire library and not just the one document. So we need to start worrying a little bit and being able to manage security on all these different things, whether they're on Office 365 and all the things that come with Office 365 now, and there's going to be even more next week at Ignite, the SharePoint team sites, so OneDrive for Businesses, which scare you a little bit, OneDrive for Business, because it really gives an individual person, a user, the ability to start working straight from there, right? Instead of putting things in the team site. So without proper policies and without checking security often, you could be inviting them to share things with people outside, with the wrong people, or having work documents that should be in team sites in that OneDrive for Business. So it definitely gets complicated as we go, and we have to be looking out for it. Anything you want to add, Antonio, on this one?
No, I think you've covered it well there. Office 365 does introduce some new concepts that you've also got to take into account outside of SharePoint.
Exactly.
Groups, OneDrive for Business and the like. Yeah.
Yeah, no, things are growing, it's changing, so let's get started. This is when the session is actually going to begin. We've let it all out. We talked about our problems or the things we've seen, and hopefully already some few tips that you may have learned, or just reassure yourself that you're doing it the right way, hopefully. And let's look at what we've learned and how you can change from there. So first, I mean, this is the most important part. If you don't know SharePoint, get to know SharePoint. That is, I couldn't stress this enough. SharePoint is not just a website where you're going to put files on. It is a beast of a platform. It's huge. It requires a lot of work, but it most importantly requires a lot of knowledge. If you don't understand the structure of a site, lists, libraries, site columns, content types, views, pages, permission levels, permission groups, security groups, I should say, all of these things are crucial, because once you're going to want to apply permissions to them, if you don't understand them properly, then you're probably going to run into potential security risk, if I can call it that. Would you agree, Antonio? Yeah.
Absolutely. I think you touched on a really good word, and that's calling SharePoint a platform. It is very much a platform that has a lot of different capabilities to it, right? It's about enabling people to collaborate, people to share information. So that brings in a lot of different concepts. Getting to know and understand those concepts, especially with how you secure information, how you secure sensitive information using the different SharePoint features, I think is one of the most important tips that we can offer here.
Absolutely.
Right, and it might require training, it might require attending conferences, it might require just a lot of reading and learning and experimenting with it, but it's a really critical step for administrators and power users to really get to know SharePoint.
Absolutely. I was going to run into that, actually. I know there's a lot of webinars recorded on Protiviti website that we can go get. Same thing on the ShareGate site if you're interested to read up on more. The idea also, just as a tip, we've done this for one of our, a couple of our customers now. It's gone quite popular. And in Office 365, there's a new thing called the video portal. And you don't have to use the video portal. I'm just using that as an example. What we've done is we've recorded some short videos, maybe 3 to 5 minute long videos. And they're training videos on SharePoint for that particular customer of ours, so that when their power users or their individual end users needed to get started with SharePoint, they would just go to the video portal, and there would be different channels. They could search the videos, and that would help them get started. But because they were short 3-5 minute videos, it didn't take too much time from their office, from their work. So it was really ideal. We've seen a lot of success in helping them know SharePoint, and we in return, we've got a lot less support tickets. Or when we got them, they were a lot more knowledgeable with questions that were actually problems that we needed to solve. And of course, we saw a lot of lot less problems with the SharePoint security overall, because people knew what they were doing. They knew broken permissions would do this. They knew they had to create a new group and not assign permissions directly and so on. So definitely with the training, highly recommend. So this one is, understand that not everything can be assigned security. So what we're going to do, right, because you got to know when you can apply security on something. When can you, there's objects in SharePoint, and some objects, not all, can be granted permissions on them too. So you can say this person has access to it, or this one does not have access to it. So I'm going to go over them very quickly and understand, right? You have SharePoint sites, and for me, a site is really like a box. It's a container. This is what essentially SharePoint gives. It allows you to give sites to power users so that they themselves, or teams and business units, can create things themselves by you giving them a site. So a site can be granted permissions on it. And within a site, you'll have lists and document libraries, which are essentially tables. These objects can also be granted permissions. And then finally, inside these lists and libraries, you will have folders and documents and or items for lists. And these are the only objects that you can apply permissions to, right? So let's recap. Sites can be applied permissions to, lists and libraries, folders, documents, and items. Antonio, am I forgetting anything that we can apply security to?
No, I think you've covered all the main ones. And again, what we're talking about here, because when you say SharePoint security, that's a big topic, right? You can talk about a lot of different things. We're specifically talking about permissions within SharePoint. I think you've covered all of that.
Perfect. So this is a traditional one, is no, you cannot put security on your SharePoint views. As we were saying, there's some things that you can apply permissions to and others that you cannot. We've listed, we said sites, lists, libraries, folders, documents, and items. And document sets, if we want to get a little technical, actually. But these are the only things that you can apply permissions to. A SharePoint view is a way to look at the content in a list or in a document library, but it does not restrict any access to the items within it. So let me give you an example, because I've heard and seen many cases where people have tried to apply or think they've applied permissions through views. Right? If you have a list of, let's say offices, or let's say partners, and say you have a list of partners, and you want to give from the entire list of partners to one of your colleagues the partners that are in the United States, and to the other colleague the partners that are in Canada, and you want to create a view that is called Partners US and one view called Partners Canada. These views are not permissions. That means the person that is in charge of Partners Canada and looks at the views for Partners Canada can still completely see every single partners, including the ones in the US. And that includes, if you've created a view with one of the customized thing, like me, to see only things that are created by you, for example. Antonio, what do you think? Is there anything else, or have you seen something around views like this? Are people doing this on your side of things as well?
Yeah, I have seen cases where people have tried to use views to secure access to content, and you know, they might even customize a page so that someone can't get out of view. But if you happen to share the URL to a particular view, then they're still going to be able to get at it.
Absolutely.
Views are not a security mechanism at all.
So what would you recommend, if I can ask? I mean, because there's another thing called audience targeting, and that also is nothing to do with permission. It's just what can people see. And it's we're seeing that views and audience targeting, it's all about what people can see, but has nothing to do with permission. So if I have a list where I wanted to tag things with U.S. and tag things with Canada, what would be the best thing or best way for me to be able to grant different permissions on it? Would that be the case where I would have to split into two lists, for example, or what would you recommend?
So that's definitely one option, right? One option, like you mentioned, is to split those things into two different lists and assign the permissions at the list level. You can go to each individual item and set permissions on those items, but that can be pretty, you know, that can be a lot of work depending on how many items you have. Then there's also third-party tools or building your own tool for assigning those permissions. So, you know, there's a third-party tool from a company I used to work for called Titus that you know about, Ben, that allows you to do that in an automated way. So you can either look to these third-party solutions or you can build your own. There's some great APIs in SharePoint. Or you can also use workflows as well.
That's true.
If you're in a situation where you're building workflows, you can control that as well.
Perfect.
So you really do need to look at a way to assign permissions. And if those permissions are going to change often, then you need to look at a way of automating that change, like we said, through workflows or something else. If the permissions aren't going to change often, then it might be worth it to split up that list into two different lists.
Yeah, I think it comes down to you got to know how SharePoint works. We've mentioned that, but you've got to know what you want to do with a list or document library before you actually get into it, because it's going to impact how you're going to build it, right? Whether it's going to be two lists or it's going to be with workflows and so on. And I think it's the same with columns and content types, right? You can't put permissions on that, can you?
No, you can't. Absolutely. And I think what you're talking about is you want to look at the life cycle of a list. Like is it going to change often? What's it going to be used for? Columns and content types, as you're saying, those are not securable objects. You can't assign permissions to those. There are some third-party tools out there that kind of they do implement kind of a security mechanism using those items, and some work better than others. But you know, at their core, you can't secure items based on a column or a content type, so that only people can see a particular column.
That's right, and I think it's very important to say, because often people add a content type, say invoices or contracts in a document library, and then expect to be able to filter or change permissions based on that content type. And you know, the fact is you cannot. You can only do it at the site list library or apply permissions we were talking about. Of course, we got to be careful with our terminology, but definitely is a big part. Whoops, it's going too fast. There we go. So how does it all work, right? How does permissions exactly work? We're talking about inheriting and breaking all the time. We're talking about the different objects that we can apply permissions to. So what would you say is the way that SharePoint works in terms of inheriting and breaking inheritance?
Sure. So we'll keep it pretty high level for this, because you can get pretty deep with permissions and permissions inheritance.
Okay.
Right. So like we said, SharePoint security is a pretty broad topic. You can talk about things like authentication to get into SharePoint. You can talk about how SharePoint is deployed from a security perspective. Here we're talking specifically about permissions inside of SharePoint. So how do I control access to content? And ultimately, SharePoint's built around an inherited permission model. And what that means is that when you create a new site collection, you start off with one permission assigned to that site collection that gives certain users access to it. Actually, you start off with several permissions, because when you create a site collection, SharePoint's automatically going to create an owners group, a members group, a visitors group, a few other default groups, and it's going to assign permissions specifically to those. But that's kind of a separate topic. So if you envision you've got a new site collection, you know, your home site, let's say, and you have an initial set of permissions at that level, then everything below that site collection, so any subsites, any lists, libraries, folders, items, or documents that you create, they're going to automatically inherit permissions from that site collection. So
I think there's actually
a new library.
Do you want the next slide that could perhaps help you with that?
Yeah, this is a great slide, Ben. So you know, when I create a new library or a new subsite, it automatically inherits the permission from the site collection level. And what that means is if someone has access to the site collection level, as you're showing here, you and I have access to the site collection, we will automatically get access to everything below that, everything that's contained within that site collection. And now what you can do is at any one of these levels, so at the site level, the child sites, the lists or libraries, folders, even items or documents, you can break that inheritance. And what that means is you actually navigate to that level and you break the permission inheritance so that you assign permissions specifically to some other user or some other group. Right? Now to do this, you do need to have the important permissions yourself within SharePoint. In fact, you have to have a permission called Manage Permissions at the level where you're going to break permissions in order to configure them this way. And you know, breaking inheritance and assigning specific permissions, if you go to the next slide, Ben, I think we'll see an example of this. Yeah, right here.
Is that Liam? That looks like Liam Cleary.
I think that is Liam. So what we've done here is we've gone to the child site level, and we've broken inheritance. We've broken permission hairs at that level, and we've assigned specific permissions to these other two people, the lady you've got there and then Liam, one of my colleagues. And what will happen here is that these other two people are going to get access to that child site level, and then everything below that is going to inherit permissions from that level because we've broken inheritance at the child site. Now, this is a useful feature when you have a site collection with many subsites, and perhaps one of those subsites has some specialized content or some particularly sensitive content to the organization. And maybe that content needs to be only visible or accessible by a particular group or particular users. So you can go to that particular level, break that permission inheritance, and assign permissions only to the people that need to access it.
Perfect. And it's the limited access is another story in itself, isn't it? Because as limited access get added, as we can see, it's required, as Antonio has mentioned, to be able to drill, to navigate down, right? So if I'm not mistaken, you said they don't have access to the site collection and the sites that we see in this diagram, that Liam and, let's say, Natasha here, they don't have access to above where the permission has been broken, but we still That's see right. them as limited access, but that means they don't have access, right?
That's right. So what SharePoint will do is when I break inheritance at the child site level, and I gave permissions to Natasha and Liam, SharePoint will automatically add a special permission called limited access up at the levels above, so the site collection level and the site level here. And that gives Liam and Natasha just enough permissions to be able to navigate to the site collection level, to the sites, and finally to the child sites where they actually have permissions. So that's why that happens automatically, so that those people have enough rights to actually be able to navigate to the places where they're legitimately supposed to access content.
Perfect. That makes a lot more sense why we see limited access everywhere when we go in our SharePoint and why it's important sometimes not to delete that limited access that you see. Because if you delete the limited access, and this, again, has happened, and that's why I put it there, because one day we're granting access to someone and they're accessing your files and your sites and whatnot, and then the next day they call you and they say, I can't access it anymore, what's going on? And truth be told is one of the person in charge of the parent object, so one of the sites above, who didn't understand why he was seeing that user in his permissions and decided to remove that limited access, which effectively broke that permission. So the person could no longer access what he had. So if you're going to delete it, you can, you just have to be careful that it is no longer needed below in the child objects. And what would you recommend, Antonio? Do you usually tell people to delete, clean up their limited access, leave it be? What would be your take on this?
So limited access causes a lot of confusion, like you're saying, for a lot of people in SharePoint. I tend to recommend that people don't clean them up, that they leave them there, because as you're saying, if you do delete them, depending on the version of SharePoint, that can have other impacts that you don't realize. The downside here is that when you do go edit permissions, there are times where SharePoint does not clean up those limited accesses itself. So they can tend to pile up even if you have removed permissions for people down lower when they were, you know, where they were supposed to have access and you were legitimately removing those permissions. So I tend to recommend that people leave them there. because okay. you can inadvertently remove somebody's access.
Absolutely. 100% yeah. agree with that one. And that brings us to permission levels, because limited access is a permission level. And what these are permissions or granted permissions that are grouped together. So full control will have everything. Design will have different checkboxes or different rights. There you go. That's the word. Different rights that are grouped together, like view, add, update, delete, approve, customize. You can click and go directly in it to see more. And these are the permission levels. So these are the type of rights that you would grant to a user or group or a SharePoint group. We'll talk about those after as well. So essentially, my recommendation, and I believe Antonio's as well, is not to edit the out-of-the-box permission levels ever. I mean, there are cases where you say, if you understand SharePoint and you understand the ramifications of what you're doing, then perhaps, and then again, I'm not 100% sure you should, but the best idea is go inside one of the permission level you're planning on using and copy it. There's a button there to copy the permission level, and you can copy it and use it or edit that one, but hopefully you're not going to edit the out-of-the-box built-in that are used for many things inside of SharePoint.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. We don't recommend changing the out-of-box ones there. You can easily copy them. For example, I've run into cases where, you know, people do want to delegate some aspect of managing sites to business users, and they want to give them some level of full control, but not everything that full control gives you. So they'll often copy full control. You know, they might call it full control restricted or site owner or something like that.
Yeah, that's the one I use, site owner.
Remove some of the capabilities from it, like creating subsites, like you say. Perhaps managing permissions. If you do want to centralize permissions management, say, in the IT group, and maybe you don't want your site owners to be able to do that, you can easily remove that permission from it. The permission levels are customizable, like you said. There's some that are not, like limited access is not customizable. And when you do create a custom permission level, you're going to have a list of 33 very specific permissions to choose from.
And that brings us to two specific permission levels. There's one called edit and there's one called contribute. Now, historically, we've always used contribute because that's the one that existed to, let's say, edit. And in SharePoint 2007, 2010, the members group that is automatically created, depending on your settings, of course, but usually the automatically created members group in a site or site collection will have the contribute rights. And that allowed them to add or remove content, but not add or remove lists and libraries. And in 2013, the members group has automatically been granted the edit instead. So they got promoted, but if you're going from 2010 to 2013, you might not be aware, but your members group now have the ability to create and delete list libraries. And so that is definitely worrying for me when I'm doing these migrations. So my tip today is definitely watch out for that edit permission level that's going to sneak up on you when you go to 2013 or Office 365. You're going to have to plan for it accordingly. Did you have anything to add, or should we go to this one directly?
No, I think you made a really good point there. Edit is new. It gives more capabilities that people didn't necessarily realize. It allows you to add lists. Specifically, it gives you the manage list capabilities, which allows you to add lists, delete lists. It makes the user a list administrator, which even has other capabilities like allowing someone to declare and undeclare records if you're in SharePoint, if you're limiting that to just list administrators.
So that is definitely very scary because that means we no longer have that content contributor by default anymore. We just have visitors to the site, people that create and manage lists, and we have the owners with full control. So gonna have to plan for that.
Exactly.
Would you say we have to be careful with assigning permissions everywhere? Because as the picture shows...
Absolutely. So when it comes to assigning permissions, I always find it's important for organizations to figure out how are we going to manage permissions? Are we going to centralize it with IT, or are we going to delegate it to site owners or content owners, or what are sometimes called data owners, people that know in the organization who should access this type of information? some companies have a different data owner per department, for example, and elsewhere that might be at a higher level or a lower level. So it's important to define that, who's going to control permissions, because you do have to have some control around it. You definitely don't want to allow permissions to be assigned everywhere. You want it to be done in a careful manner. And the way you plan that out is usually done through a governance plan, where you make those decisions about how are we going to control permissions, where do our end users go when they need to get permissions, when they need to, to legitimately get access to content they need to use day to day. And establishing those types of things and letting people know those policies, those company security policies, goes a long way at, you know, preventing permissions from being assigned everywhere.
Yeah, no, I 100% agree with that. It becomes quite scary. This is your famous slide, so I will let you lead with that one.
Sure. So this is getting back to a point we made earlier related to performance. So there are certain limitations in SharePoint when it comes to assigning permissions. Very specifically at the list and library level, there are limitations or recommended limitations around how many unique permissions you should assign at those levels. So whenever you break inheritance on something, it creates what's called a security scope in SharePoint. And that's just a name for a unique permission, let's say. There's a few other aspects to it, but that's kind of the core concept. And there's limits on lists and libraries on the number of security scopes or on the number of unique permissions you can have. So if you envision a large library, and by large I mean let's say a library that has 10,000 documents in it, or let's say 30,000 documents in it. If you start breaking inheritance on each individual document, so let's say this document, only Jack can see this document, this other document, only Nancy can see this document, and you do that for a very large number of documents in that library or list, you're going to start to approach some of these limitations. So for any list or library, right, there's a threshold of 50,000 unique permissions on that list or library. And you know, certainly you should try to keep the number of permissions on that list or library, unique permissions, much lower than that, right? Microsoft tends to recommend keep that below 5,000 unique permissions on that list or library. But you can go as high as 50,000, but really it's above 50,000 where you start to see performance degradation in the system. Yeah. Now, that's very much based on the architecture of the system, databases, how many nodes in your cluster you have, the size of your system, and so on. But that tends to be the general threshold there. And the other important limitation we talk about is the size of a security scope. And what that means is the number of users or groups, for example, that have that permission on a particular item, document, folder, library, or site. And if for any particular permission you've got, you know, more than 5,000 users, that is actually a hard limit there. You can't pass 5,000 unique users or groups that can have access to a particular document or item.
Interesting.
The overall important point here is to understand the boundaries and the limits. Microsoft has some great documentation on that, not only for permissions and security scopes, but for many other items within SharePoint. Lots of other aspects of SharePoint have certain boundaries and limits. They're all configurable, but you have to be aware of where those boundaries and limits are when you start talking about a lot of data or a lot of permissions.
Yeah, so and I was going to say the same thing about the software boundaries. I'm glad you brought it up in your slide. It's to really understand. And I discovered just now when you were talking about 5,000 unique users, it's not something that I have ran into, but it's definitely very good to know. And if the planning is done properly, then we can make sure that we never run into these problems beforehand. So first lesson of the session, did we get first lesson and it's 2:50? Yeah, no, don't worry, there's a lot of things in there quickly, some tips there, but first, definitely don't give full control to everyone. That's what we were talking about earlier. Then how is access given to people exactly? Well, if you're not going to give full control, you're going to have to want to look at SharePoint groups versus Active Directory groups. And Antonio and I go back and forth on this one because and there's some good points on both, so you'll have to look at it. and do note that what I've talked, the mention at the bottom, changing members of SharePoint groups will launch a full crawl. That's good for SharePoint 2007, 2010. It's not the issue anymore in 2013 in Office 365. In fact, even I think in one of the service packs of 2010, when I was doing some research, it might have been removed. What's important is to understand is whether you're going to put SharePoint groups and grant access in SharePoint to these SharePoint groups, or you're going to just manage everything through Active Directory, which I also recommend for sure, because Active Directory groups is keeping everything in one place and manageable in one location. On the other hand, all of the rights that you're granting to Active Directory groups, if anything happened to those groups in Active Directory, they disappear, they get deleted, they get disabled, the whole SharePoint permissions that you had on list or library get broken in that effect. Whereas if you have granted them to SharePoint groups, whenever you back up the SharePoint database, whenever you pick it up and go somewhere else, all of the permissions will be assigned to objects that exist within the SharePoint database, which is good on its own. So you got to look at it in both ways and figure out whether you prefer using SharePoint groups and adding Active Directory groups in the SharePoint groups, still allows you to manage through Active Directory, however adding a lot of back and forth and effort, or you can go straight to Active Groups and bypass the SharePoint groups, however you'll be depending directly on Active Directory for the permissions management. So that's, I mean, Antonio, do you have anything to add on that one?
Yeah, there's pros and cons to both approaches. It kind of depends on what the requirements or the needs of the organization are. I personally prefer Active Directory groups, as you mentioned, because then you're managing all of your groups and your group membership in one place, and you can make sure that all of your groups follow your corporate policies for groups. But when you do that, that means that your users in SharePoint can't change or edit or even view the membership of those groups, right? And because usually you don't make your average business user an Active Directory admin, rightfully so. So if you're in an organization where your business users, say, need to see who's in a SharePoint group, or they need to be able to edit a SharePoint group, then SharePoint groups become a really viable option in SharePoint, where you can have this separate group mechanism that's completely separate from any groups. You can create those within SharePoint. You can manage those within SharePoint. And those can be used to assign, you know, permissions and access to content. So there's pros and cons to both options. SharePoint groups are not managed all in one place. Each site collection is going to have its own set of groups. So you need to be aware of that when it comes to, from an IT perspective, looking at, okay, what are all the SharePoint groups I have in my system?
Good. And the lesson two here, when we're talking about, is exactly that. Try to use AD groups. Now, this is not saying, oh, you know, Antonio was right. It's we're saying, regardless, you should be starting from Active Directory groups and use them when possible. SharePoint groups is an extra layer, but you should definitely be at least starting with AD groups. And what we're saying is don't give permissions directly to a user. But you have to understand the settings of the actual group itself, the SharePoint group that you create as well. And Antonio was telling me just yesterday how he was just working with that right now, is understanding who the owner of the group is. Because the owner of the group, that other group or the user, right, the group owner, is going to be in charge of that SharePoint group that you're creating. This can be a user, but it can also be another group out there. So in this case, we're having the members group being owned by the owners group. And then in the further settings, you'll see who can view the membership of the group. Is it everyone or the group members? And who can edit the membership of the group? Is it the owner or the other member? So who can add people to this group? Is it the owners group or is it going to be other members that we have in this case? So very important to properly understand all of these settings, including whether or not you're going to allow requests to join and leave this group and whether you're not going to auto-accept them and just log them into emails. So definitely look into the settings when you're creating these, because that will definitely have a huge impact once you're managing your SharePoint sites, lists, libraries, and so on.
Yep, especially, you know, if you're working in a high security area where your information is very sensitive and for whatever business reason you decide to use SharePoint groups, understanding in particular that group owner field and the fact that whoever you set there, they're, you know, based on the other settings that you see below, they're going to have the ability to edit that group. It's important to control who is in that group owner field, because they're the people that's going to be able to change membership. And if you're using the SharePoint group to grant access to content, all someone needs to do is go and change the membership of the SharePoint group, and then they'll have access to that content.
Yeah. Lesson three, never grant permissions directly to a user. So I just said that when we were talking about the full control. The individual user is the worst thing that we can do by giving them direct permissions, because later on when that person leaves the company, or you want to copy permissions from one person to another, you want to add somebody to the marketing team, and you want them to, it's going to be chaos, because we're never going to know where Joe or John or Stephanie or Julia, where they had access in SharePoint. So the more you grant permissions directly to a user, the harder or the more chaos you create for permissions management overall in many different ways. So as much as possible, never do that, because then this happens. Hey, Antonio, can you tell me what Benjamin has access to in our SharePoint? And you won't be able to answer, because there's no way to figure it out easily without going to each one and figuring out whether the on the opposite, where you can just create. I know I'm disappointed too, but what about external users? Can we see what they have access to? No, same thing.
Unfortunately, no.
Yeah, very, very difficult. And so that's why granting permissions directly to a user, right? It's easier to create a group, call them whatever you want, put the user's individual in there, even if it's the CEO of your company, and you think that he should have access to whatever he wants, of course, but you still create a group called CEO, because eventually there may be another CEO. So you want to be able to grant permissions to groups as much as you can. Right, Antonio? I'm not mistaken here.
No, absolutely right. Granting permissions to individual users has a number of issues. You've touched on several of them. Really, it comes down to, after the fact, if you need to report on or figure out who has access to content, that becomes extremely difficult to do with users all over the place. And SharePoint does not have great out-of-box features for that. So using groups, lets you abstract that at one level, and instead of managing permissions on individual users, it allows you to manage permissions, hopefully, on a smaller set of groups.
Absolutely, and always try to do that. So I'm going to go over the governance very quickly. There's a full blog post that you can check with the URL down below. It's how to set up a governance plan. There's tons of ways. The method that I like to do is very straightforward, very simple. I use wiki pages, link them together, and I build it as you go. The idea is to have some sort of policies and management on it, so you can see that if we use the team sites, the first row at the top, or the big blue box on the left, bottom left here, if we create a team site, it comes with 15 gigabytes. It's going to be locked down 90 days after the date or after the last modification. The security policy, the site management policy is uncontrolled. And what that means, uncontrolled, is in a separate part of the governance policy. And we're going to say, yes, you're allowed to create lists and subsites, or no, controlled, you can't create anything, only these specific groups of people are allowed to do things in there, and who has permissions to the site. So you'll see that in many sites, in many scenarios, I'll try to create permissions and grant permissions only at the site level as long as possible. I never start breaking permissions below the site. Of course, there's always exceptions, and there's always the reality that comes into play, but as much as I can, I try to keep it at the highest possible level, the longest possible time, so that I can manage permissions a lot easier later on, and just add somebody to a site instead of trying to figure out which lists and libraries and documents and folders they should be granted to. So keep it simple. The 27-page governance document is not going to work. Nobody's going to read it, not even you, except the first time you write it. So be sure that in terms of governance, you keep it simple so people consume it. The idea of the governance plan is to help guide users and put them into right path or right direction when using the platform. It's not about reading a manual on what to do and what not to do, because people are not going to read it and not going to follow it. So try to look at that. There's definitely also the sharing that you have to be watching out for, right? Because if I'm not making, how does the share work? I think it's the next slide too. And that's why training is important, of course, but sharing, when I grant permissions and I type in the name of a user, What happens? Does permissions get broken, Antonio? I'm not exactly sure on the share button.
So yeah, when you share content, individual documents, for example, with other people, inheritance will get broken on that document, and it will create unique permissions on that document. So through this feature, you know, Microsoft's enabling you to very easily, very quickly share individual documents and items with different users. And you can do it just by specifying their email address, for example. It will break inheritance on the document, and it will add to those limitations or those numbers that we talked about earlier.
That's right. The break, if people just click share, something happens, the person that they wanted to share it with gets the document perfect, but behind the scenes, a lot of things are happening, breaking permissions are happening, performance is going slower the more we do this, so you have to be careful with the share button, and that's why we keep saying training is important. If your users understand that they shouldn't share, they should add the people to the right groups, or that they should look to the right person to do the permissions management, or you to have to do the process of who can click on share and who can do what is extremely important. And that's why we were talking about training, whether it's videos, whether it's in class, whether it's going to the Protiviti conference or in Reston. It's important to go to these things and figuring out how it works before you put it into place. Go ahead.
Sorry, just to add one point, Ben. One important point, that we're not saying that the share feature is bad or that you shouldn't use it or that it causes problems.
That
people should understand the ramifications of it, the fact that permission inheritance is broken. Right, permission inheritance, like I said, is a really useful feature. It is important to be able to secure access to specific documents and items sometimes. That's just something you need to do, and SharePoint does support that. You just need to understand the limitations and the impact of doing that.
Absolutely. It's funny because we've given this presentation before. We had gone a few minutes over time. We removed slides, and we're still a little bit over time. Thank you for staying. It's just a few more slides here. We're already at lesson number four, which is almost a last one, if I'm not mistaken. So help them understand why item-level permissions is bad. We talked about that. Yes, in SharePoint, you don't see what you don't have access to, but on the other hand, you see everything that you have access to with search. So we talked about that earlier. Be careful with that because the search indexes everything, so the smallest mistake in SharePoint could lead to what we were talking about. Now, it's not the exact same thing with Snowden, but it could be where as soon as you've gotten the administrative privileges or as soon as you've gotten certain rights, you can use search and find everything that you were given access to. So, of course, SharePoint permissions goes way beyond what we saw today. There's SQL Server, there's claims permissions, there's tons of things, isn't there, Antonio?
Absolutely. Like we said earlier, there's a lot of different aspects to security and permissions in SharePoint. We've kind of covered, I think, the most important aspects here, but there's a lot more behind this as well.
Absolutely. And in fact, just for fun, if you guys could Google or Bing the word view, just what's in quote, view all side content. Just for fun, go online, click on view all side content, and you'll see that a lot of SharePoints that are out there, you can actually see what you have in there. So lots of crazy things in terms of security there, where people put their SharePoint online and you just see their SharePoint. You go to view all site content, and as Liam Cleary shows in one of his sessions, which is Hack SharePoint, as soon as you know where things are and what they are called, it's a lot easier to hack them than not knowing where they are. So just the fact that the lockdown feature was not enabled on sites disabled this view all site content. And in fact, I think one of the first results is something like the NASA or some government's security agency. So definitely be careful with that. Make sure your site's not one of the view all site content.
Yep.
Of course, retention policies, archives, how security is maintained on these. Antonio, would you use, you were talking about records earlier and people getting access to records. Is this something that you should still be maintaining security on, or how does it usually work for you on your side?
Absolutely. So, you know, a number of organizations, they look at their corporate records as something that needs to be managed. Sometimes records are actively used. Sometimes they can, you know, be moved to another site where they're not usually accessed. And something being a record in SharePoint has specific aspects. It has specific properties. For one, a record can't be deleted. It can't be changed. And two, it has a certain retention period associated with it. It has a period of time with which you'll keep it. Declaring something a record in SharePoint does make it so it can't be deleted. But what we alluded to earlier, you do have to be careful with who has the ability to undeclare records. That's kind of one of these security aspects to records where you usually want a record manager or a very small set of people to have that ability to undeclare records.
Because that would defeat the purpose, wouldn't it?
That's right. That's exactly it. So you do need to understand how you control that in SharePoint.
Great. And this is something that I keep saying. I think this is really we're touching the end here is IRM and RMS. And people don't use these enough, especially when you're on Office 365. It's all set up for you already, and you just have to use it. And on premises, you have to actually set up a server and a KPI or certificate infrastructure if you want, but it's some really powerful stuff, such as who's allowed to print this document, right? So it allows you to grant permissions, and the one on Office 365 by default are very light, but they're still very powerful, and the one on premises can really go beyond what we're seeing here on documents and really prevent certain things from happening on documents. Like, for example, here we can see that you can block somebody from running a script or a screen reader, preventing people screen capturing while the document is in browser mode. There's tons of things, but I think the one I use the most, and it's the one I mentioned, is the allowing people to print when they're visiting or opening my document. And it works even if the document is no longer in SharePoint, if somebody copied it elsewhere, if the rights were granted, the rights management were done on it, and the security still applies to it, the security still applies to it. So definitely look into IRM, RMS. You may already have it if you're on Office 365, so it's worth taking a look. You go to library settings if it's connected, and under library settings, you'll be able to set these things. And I know Antonio's a big fan of these as well. He had written a very, very good blog post on RMS, if I remember correctly, right, Antonio?
Yeah, that's right. That's right.
So definitely
check that out, too. These are great, powerful features in SharePoint. Like you mentioned, these are really nicely set up in Office 365 where it's already set up for you. It's really easy to configure and to use. What happens with IRM in SharePoint is that when you download the document, it gets encrypted, and it gets encrypted for just certain people so that even if that document ends up off of your desktop onto some other personal computer, it's only encrypted for certain people. So even if it gets emailed out to the world, they're not going to be able to access it. And along with it, you've got these rights that Benjamin talked about, preventing people from being able to print it. And one of the rights that I really like is the expiry that you can set on documents. So allow people to be able to open it for, say, 30 days, and then they can no longer open it.
That is definitely another very good one, yeah. And I like it because it also makes sure that if you have a document that you know, as you said, expires, but the document you know is going to be valid only for 30 days, and you don't want them to see it after, not because you don't want them to have access to it, simply because you know that data is going to be no longer good, and you want them to find a new document instead, right?
Yep. Yeah, exactly. There's a lot of purposes to it.
Of course. So as we said, SharePoint security goes way beyond SharePoint. It's everything. It's your firewall. It's your servers. It's your SQL. It's Active Directory. You could just look at how the servers are set up for Office 365. That is incredible. Of course, they don't give us the details because that's the first tip of security is don't tell how you secured it. But it is very, very impressive. So, but all this to say, with security in SharePoint, it's good to understand the basics, some of the stories, the limitations, what we've covered with Antonio today, some tips in terms of the structure on how to plan things and how it all works. But you have to look way beyond just a simple SharePoint security, of course. We both thank you very, very much, both Antonio and I. I'll leave with the last slide for you to be able to register or look at the URLs for the SharePoint Project Management Symposium. Antonio, whoa, where's my slide? Thank you very much. I think we're going to do some questions as well.
I think so. Thanks, everyone, for your time.
Yes, we're going to get to a couple questions. Thank you, Antonio and Benjamin. Lots of great information there. Okay, so the first question is it always when we delete some permission in the sites, even if the permission is broken, it will affect the permission in the child sites? I think she means deleted as well.
So I can begin. I think if you grant permissions to something or someone, the child side automatically inherit. Now they will just use that permission from the parent. However, if the child site is using unique permissions or broken, it is only at the time where you break the permission inheritance that things are copied from the parent site or parent object to the child. But afterwards, that broken inheritance object is on its own. So if you add things above, it won't automatically go down to that, unless, Antonio, am I mistaken here?
No, that's correct. If you've broken inheritance on a particular subsite, a child site, you'll need to manage the permissions on that child site specifically. Changing permissions above that is not going to affect the child site.
I hope that answers the question.
Yeah.
Okay, great. One other question we have is, what happens to customized permissions when you're upgrading to a higher SharePoint? So from SharePoint 2010 to SharePoint 2013.
Antonio, you want to take that one?
Sure. So I think that depends very much on how you migrate from 2010 to 2013. Those types of, you know, moving from 2010 to 2013 is never simply an upgrade. It's always a migration. And, you know, depending on the amount of content, you can look at third-party tools like the ShareGate tool, which is a fabulous tool for migrating from 2010 to 2013. And, you know, it will migrate the permissions over for you. But it does have some dependencies on groups or users that are set up in the destination sites, I'll say. Ben, you live in the migration space.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what I was going to say. It really depends on what kind of migration you're doing. Are you doing database attached? Are you changing domains? There's a lot of factors that plays in place. Yeah. However, usually if you're in a very standard migration, you're staying in your environment, you're going from 2010 to 2013, usually your permission levels will just get migrated just as easily to the destination and shouldn't have too many ramifications. The worries, especially with the new edit permission levels, and it's more change management, it's more setting the expectations to people that you used to give people the members group thinking they're just going to add or remove documents and now realizing that they can do more.
Yeah, exactly. From my perspective, migrations, usually you need to try it, and that's where you usually see the issues come up that you're going to run into.
Yes.
And then you go back to the original farm, you fix those issues, and you retry the migration again.
Okay, great. Thank you both for joining us today, and thank you everyone on the call for staying a little bit over. I know it's a lot of information, but again, you can view the recording of today's session on our YouTube channel, youtube.com/ProtivitySP. Thank you, Benjamin and Antonio, for presenting today. We really appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thanks,
everyone, for joining us. Have a great day.